Lopez is going to be starting right now. The map will be Mirage. It's Astralis versus Lounge Gaming. Astralis starting on the T side. Four sets of armor for them. One utility player in the form of Carrigan as well. It's actually looking like they're going to be setting up a little bit of a decoy here towards the A side. We've got Carrigan with that smoke towards A, and the rest of his teammates towards the B apartments in middle. Smoke towards jungle, and we'll see where they decide to go with this one.
Well, it is Cajun B that starts it off. The cleaner. Can you believe that that's what he wants to be called? I hope he wears a maid's outfit if that's what he wants his name to be. I've always liked guys dressed in maid outfits, but Michu gonna take down Carrigan. They've actually brought this back because Innocent's got a kill as well, and it sits 2-4 versus 3. Innocent is well in behind the bench. He's gonna drop the bomb. Zipix is the one that he'll take down, but Device has made it inside of the site and makes it interesting as well. Takes down Michu in the window, and that makes the bomb recoverable. Still though, he's got work to do, 22 HP, and it favors CSGO Lounge in that sense. He's gonna swap over to the USB.
Dupree coming from the kitchen as well. The backstab is true. He went for the burst fire. That's unbelievable. Now it's going to be Mouse taking him down. What was that? At that sort of range, that's a horrible decision. It's going to be CSGO Gaming picking it up. That's absolutely incredible. I'm not really sure why you'd go for burst fire. Maybe he wasn't aware it was on that mode, but it's almost useless in CSGO unless you're literally pointing the gun down their throat. So the 2-on-2, well, it looked like Astralis had the positional advantage as well. It does go in favor of Lounge Gaming. And the force buy coming in from Astralis now after they didn't get the bomb down there. It looked so promising from the start as well. They get the opening pick. They get into the B site. Device finds those two frags. It just wasn't enough. And number two now. You can see two SMGs and a scout coming out for Lounge Gaming. It's up to the Desert Eagles of Astralis to try and bounce back.
Decent recovery again. They lost that first pick in the pistol round and yet still able to pull it off. Michu gets Kerrigan. Deagle not successful toward mid. Tech 9 for Cajun B. Zipix is going to fire back up toward the window, knowing that that scout was there. Saw him jumping up the first time, but he's fallen back just slightly, his Spiro. Meanwhile, Mazino, though, gets a lot closer. That UMP, good range, takes down the cleaner, and then it's Device to turn it back around, though. Deva, if we're going to use all their alternate names. Zipix is up toward middle, Deagle in hand, but he's going to be spotted out as well. Dupree, that time's better. No burst fire on the Deagle. Perhaps a lesson learned, and he will get the headshot on to Michu. So sits 3 versus 3. The problem is that the bomb's been intentionally dropped back toward the horseshoe, and losing Device in the ground they initially gained, there's going to be no chance for a plant.
Well, he managed to pick up a couple of frags with those Desert Eagles, but not meant to be. Lounge Gaming go up 2-0 here, and they do manage to keep the Scout and the MP9 alive as well. You'd assume the rest of the players will be upgrading to M4s now, but this is pretty much throwaway round. Astralis can't really justify much more than a flashbang by the looks of things. Not a single upgraded pistol as of yet. Dupree with the flash. Possibly just going to go towards A. Maybe just flash out. Yeah, so four players towards Palace. Dupree will flash them out from A ramp. They'll try to swarm the bomb site, get the bomb down, body block it. That's going to be the only objective this round. Won't be able to win it, but they can get a plan out of this and get an extra $800. Something to take away from this.
Well, to be pretty straightforward with these M4s as well. Now Zeno goes absolutely ballistic back in the CT spawn. Toward the stairs, gets 3 kills. You have to say it's pretty straightforward, but now Astralis get out the guns. And Mirage, another map where they've swapped over their AWP toward Device. Used to be dynamic. It's a little bit more straightforward, but it has been successful since their sort of attempt to revitalize themselves, I guess you could call it. Their attempt to start, you know, get these results that have been evading them for so long.
Well, Minis did have the MP9. They decided to go anti-Jaden and upgrade to an M4A4.
All right. So I like it.
They are going to keep the scout, but here we go then. First gun round comes in. We can see some aggression towards middle from Astralis. Actually looking to split A here by the looks of things as well. You can see the bomb on Zipex on the lower ramp. Dupree, of course, has made it into connector. And Carrigan gets towards window as well. It's just working out so perfectly for them. Two frags gathered so far. Mouse is stuck in towards Shadow with 19 HP, trying to work out what he can do here.
Michu sprays down Carrigan. A bomb planted. Dupree's going to sit up on top of the stairwell. Actually try and fade away from that. Does it? It's spotted by Maniz, but if anything, having only taken 26 HP, it just gives away the information to where Maniz is. So Device goes for an immediate peek, and it's all on Michu inside of the connector. Bomb planted. Pretty straightforward for this situation. They've got such good post plants, and they can actually fan out across the map. They're not going one direction to escape on this. They're actually your favorite band, Henry, getting Zipix down towards CT spawn, so Michu's going to be covered off.
You don't have to use that joke every time.
Just making sure the world knows, okay?
Well, I like to keep my private life out of the cast, if possible. Can you do that for me?
Yes, I'm sorry.
Thank you.
But right, I'm casting right beside you, which I am your private life, so that doesn't work.
That's kind of sad. You are pretty much all my life actually has right now. You are the purest thing I have, Matt, and that's quite depressing. Anyway, 3-1, Astralis bouncing back after the 3-0 deficit. Getting the first round pretty convincing as well. Fast A split coming in, attacking from all angles there. Connector, Window, A-Ram, Palace, just getting the frags. But this is where Lounge Gaming still have plenty of cash after three clean ones, and they're going to have a double offset at this time. Spiro and Manise. And I'm sure they'll be going for that aggressive first pick. Manise will be going towards the apartments. And we can see Astralis doing a very similar approach this time, going fast up towards short, and Dupree looking to get in connector.
And tries to spray through the smoke. Nothing to come out of it, but this is such good positioning. Oh my goodness, how has Kerrigan gone that far? He's already inside CT spawn. There's gonna be no way Spiro knows this. This is so perfect from Kerrigan. He's gotten in behind everyone, and they're just waiting for this. This easily could be a knife. More so, definitely gonna hold his trigger down. He's gonna get information. Oh, spots them both. Just take the lineup. Take the lineup, shoot! Now he realizes Spiro would go, wait a minute, that's in my ear. And Device gets a shot on Innocent. That was so perfect from Kerrigan.
That was kind of sick. It's very rare you get this kind of opportunities, and he almost fluffed with that first bullet, but managed to pick up two frags in the end. He is dropped by Michu in the end, but it's a 4-on-2. Manise and himself trying to work out what they can do. The double orb setup not really working out there. And they will be trying to save one of them, but you can see Dupree on towards short, trying to get that first frag. He will be dying here because KGB is going to come in for the pincer as well. So they should be able to find both frags. I'm very certain of that. Now this is going to be a case of whether they can take a few men down with them.
I mean, he's already missing that first shot. Gives Cajun a chance to walk up. They don't have to reface it. They're just going to wait for Cajun to get in position, and he's going to drop immediately. Now the question is finding the second and not losing a man. Michu, he'll get out at the hands of Zippix. Pretty straightforward. Really good. I love it from Kerrigan.
That was so cool. The fact he can get to all the way to CD spawn completely undetected as well. Finds two pretty sick frags. Like, look at this. How do you imagine if he didn't kill this and he turned around his nose scoped him?
Can't imagine.
He managed to pull it off just about. But there we go. Lounge Gaming now going to be on towards the UK. They have got Desert Eagles and PT-50s and a 5-7 for good measure. And KGB adjusting accordingly. He does get the MAC-10 out and he'll be the reconnaissance-style player going into these positions first. And looks like he'll be spread up rushing B. Astralis actually do this quite a lot, you know. They'll just send one player in. They're happy for him to sacrifice. He's just gaining the information whether it'll be a stack towards B. Got to be smoked out, so thinking better of it, but you can see the CTs now pushing offshore with the Desert Eagles, trying to find that first pick. And the bomb is towards the A ramp for Astralis.
Cajun B waits for the smoke to fade. He's got the MAC-10 so he can evaluate what's going on inside of this B site, already clearing off angles as well inside of the apartments to do so as he spots the jump. They aren't committing to any of this. They're just going to let him go to work. They're still stacked up with the bomb over toward the A site. Good run in. Manise goes down. First one found. Second on Cat spotted. And he turns back and actually goes that direction. Long range. It's Kerrigan with the AK that's going to get the shot instead. But they're all rotating this way. They're just going to walk into the A site as this happens.
Where's Remain now? Make it one. Aspiro gets dropped by KGB there. Mouse isn't remaining. And he's going to be cowering towards the apartment. Kerrigan swiftly deals with him there. And Astralis tie things up at 3-3. Looking very strong right now. Since the gun rounds have started, it's been no real problems for them. But here we go then. Lounge Gaming don't have the biggest stacks of cash to go forward with them. Round number 7. No orbs this time. Going to be 5 M4s, no kits, 3 players without body, head armor, sorry, and no incendiaries as well. So still a difficult round for them. This is the kind of round we'll see CT sides maybe pushing towards lower ramp or maybe trying to get a pick in the B apartments. We'll see what their approach is this time. It's one player towards A for now. And Spiro is holding defensively in that window area. This is the aggression I'm talking about. So Mihu pushing up middle. He just needs to find a frag here. They can't allow a full execution to come in.
Problem in doing this is that he is alone. Innocent's in connector, but with that smoke out, there would be no way to trade it. Michu doesn't need to. He takes down both Dupree and Kerrigan.
Perfect stuff from him. That's an absolute dream scenario. Flashbang working perfectly in his favor. Now we've got the bomb in the B apartments. You can see the CT now they can just fall back. They've got the advantage. They can force the terrorists to come towards them. We have got Cajun B. He's the lurker on this map, normally towards Palace or A ramp. Trying to find that next frag to get them back in this round.
And Cajun B is waiting for the entry point at this, but Astralis not set yet, just rotating back. They are going to try to still utilize middle. It's Device that wants to do so with the AWP, and Michu has gone back toward ladder room. He's going to cross this window. If he even thinks about this, there's no smoke on it. If he goes over, Device is set for this, and that would be the pick that would be required to not only get them a chance on the A side, but get Device back into the play. A connector, Cajun walks out, takes down Innocent. Now he's in the open, Device misses the shot though, and Michu does get across. So that means Device has to fall back, rotate the long way, and it leaves Zippix and Cajun, who's low, on their own, but still Cajun B finds Muzino.
Lovely stuff from Cajun B, gets him right back into this round. 3-3 now, still time to play with. Michu finds Zippix and gets a double as well. Cajun B is dropped. and the glimmer of hope they had is shut down as Mihu finds his fourth kill of the round. Device, the last player remaining now, 15 seconds. And you know what? It's going to be an ace. Why not? Perfect round from him, just when he needed it as well. Difficult buy, and he picks up an AWP.
And the what timing when he walks back into A, they're both in the open again. Go back to mid. If Device hits that shot, not only does he get connector, but Michu's gone. He can't do anything about the round, and that was such a good push as well. That push was... I mean, it started it all offshore, but there was nowhere to get, be traded there. He had to get both kills.
Absolutely. Had he gone down, that would have been an advantage towards Astralis, but he got two. We're going to round number 8 now. Mount Gaming still with a strong buy now. AWP back on Spiro. You see Astralis in a little bit weaker here. That's the first kill comes in once again for the Polish squad. Innocent taking down Carrigan. Cajun B once again trying to rectify this. He makes his way in towards A by himself towards Tetris. Going to be flash for now. The idea he picks a, finds a frag and they can make their way towards B.
Cajun's going to get up on top of Tetris. That smoke allows him the movement. Manese? No? Silencer on that M4, so those tracers, they would have known he was on the balcony. Thankfully, he's dropped away from this.
What they're trying to do there as well, after that spray, they're counting on him to do a full reload. So they're trying to walk for that smoke and catch him out, but he moved out of the way just in time. So nice work from him. KGB still trying to work a pick on this A site. Gets an opportunity. There it is. Three kills coming from Astralis. Now the A bomb site has a lot of potential for that bomb to come back to. We have got both CTs towards the B side of the map, so this has worked out very nicely indeed.
That is the saving grace, though. The bomb to come back to, which also means the rotations could come in at the same amount of time. The problem right now, though, is for Lounge Gaming is that they don't have the money. So they might just elect to give this up, allow it to happen, and save.
Yeah, and the 4-on-2, and they don't really have any control of the situation. If they had a player in CD spawn with the AWP, for example, that could have been a potential to actually try and go for this one and try and stop the bomb going down. But this kind of retake, when they've only got one flashbang as well, it's just not possible. Save the weapons, take it into next round. It is going to be a hard reset next round, so you can see they'll only get $1,400. So the buy is going to be difficult regardless. So keeping these two weapons, especially an AWP, does give you some potential to win the rounds. We see it time and time again in Mirage. If you can take the AWP towards Palace, for example, or maybe it'd be Apartments, find that first pick, reposition yourself. You've got options. Going to the next round with just pistols, obviously that's going to be an almost guaranteed round in favor of Astralis.
Zipix is hunting this. Device is already in behind Spiro. So yeah, there you go. He gets one. That's fine. You can have that. But Device was waiting all the time. So now it's just going to be Michu that left, or is left, excuse me, down toward A slope. He's gotten all the way around the outside of the map. He went through B apartments to get here. And he's done it in a, set, a fashion that Dupree's gone by him toward mid. So Cajun may not know he's here. This could be a problem. And Cajun, yeah, as a result, goes down. So Michu stays alive, and they get limited with only two guns left on the Astralis side. But they've got decent money, so they should be okay.
So then Lounge Gaming do save the AK-47, as I mentioned before. $1,400 coming in. So it's leave down to Michu. Can he make something happen here? Could go towards mid-window. Could go to underpass. Potentially, we see a lot of players try and do that, get that opening frag. He'll be turreting himself towards the B-bomb, so just trying to work a pick in that manner. But Astralis should be full aware this should be a pretty much full eco coming in. And Carrigan doesn't seem to care. He's going in straight towards the A-bomb site. Decent Molotov towards Shadow as well. There's two players waiting for him. They're going to be cooking alive as the frags do roll in. Cajun, Dupree, and Zipex pick up one each.
And Carrigan doesn't really get much of those. But again, the Molotov that went out, it was a good nade to start things off on that A-slope. But it's down to just Innocent. Carrigan closes the round, and Astralis take back the lead. And it's only two rounds since the reset. So Go Lounge will buy into this one, but they won't be able to buy into the next regardless. They're only going to get the 2,400. Now, what's the call from Spiro? He's gone for the shotgun, so he actually...
Cheeky Max 7.
Yeah, he's going to go all the way into this, but he's going to have to play a very specific angle with that gun.
Hold towards the window for the boost, maybe. Could go underpass, for example, or hold connector. Looking like he will be opting for that window position, but you see Astralis mixing things up now. Three players towards the lower ramp straight away, and Mouse going for that aggressive peak, but Dupree so ready for him. Locks him down with a sweet headshot. 5 and 4, they can just bide their time now. Don't need to force anything at this stage.
Innocent's going to repeat from the top of the stairs right now. Does decent device on damage. Excuse me, damage on device, rather. But the problem is that he had Carrigan lurking up from the connector behind him, and now Michu does get one. Limited, though. Has a second shot to line up on Zipix, but it goes the other way. Because he knew he was there. He can hold the angle. Bomb goes down him, and he's plays 1v4.
Pretty much you can do now. The economy becoming a problem for the CTs right now. They've won... Actually, one single gun round here, so and then getting reset straight after. Four spies coming in, no orbs. Max Evans trying to find the first picks there, pushing to the lower ramp. It worked so well towards middle before, with Mihu finding that ace. Not so much the same story for Mouse as he pushed the lower ramp. He got taken down straight away. Six plays four now, and the CTs will be onto pretty much full eco here. Three P250s purchased, and looking like they're going for a full bombsite ace stack. The bombs and B apartments for Astralis, so this is looking like it probably won't work out for them.
Kerrigan's going to be the one to get around the corner right now. He'll be the first to be spotted up. Sees one player, doesn't realize there's two more being aggressive, but has the inclination to run back. Instead, though, it's Michu that chases him down because the early damage came in. It's easy to clean it up. And speaking of cleaning, it is the cleaner, Cajun B. But apparently he's just going to get plunged because it's Malzino with the kill. And now Device, although lurking in behind, has to compensate for this. The fact that they're down two men does get the first. Bomb's going in on beat. They've read the stack accordingly. But again, it's economic damage that they're trying to play for. CSGO Lounge and picking up two AKs, okay. One of which is gone. The best they can do is save one gun.
Lovely stuff there from Device. Positioned himself so well. Get that double spray through the smoke. It looked like a promising round for Lounge there. They did manage to pick up two AKs, but completely shut down by Device. 7-4 now. And they do manage to actually get some decent economy. The auto sniper is coming out, interesting enough, Matt. So we have an AWP, and the auto sniper can be a very effective weapon on Mirage. Obviously, we have a lot of heavy smoke-based tactics on this one. You can spam through the smoke as they're executing and try and find a couple of picks that way. We'll see where he decides to take it. B-Mouse looking like he'll be opting towards the A-bomb site, so presumably holding CT spawn. Yep, there it is. And this could be interesting. Looks like another A-split coming in, potentially a fast one as well, judging by Dupree's movements.
Dupree tries to fire and gets blinded up slightly. Kerrigan's going to be the one to advance. Again, playing with a fast pace, this Kerrigan. And he's gotten toward the ladder room. Spotted from connectors, so they should have a read on this. Hence why Spiro goes more passive. But it's Innocent that gets him instead. Malzino follows up. The auto sniper, we don't often like this, Henry, but it works out. And they manage to get one kill with it. Dupree goes down, mid's gone. It's the two players left trying to work in the front side of A. And they haven't got a kill yet, Astralis, in this round. Very swift from Lounge.
I normally don't like the auto sniper. It's when the team's winning so many rounds in a row and they pull it out as like a little cheeky last minute surprise. That's when they seem to throw rounds at it. This adjustment I don't mind at all. It seems like Mouse, as I said, working it perfectly there. The fact that Astralis put a smoke down and flashed over, even when he smoked out and fully flashed as well, he's just spamming shots towards the lower ramp and Device just runs into all three of them. And that's the kind of potential it has. It actually, if you can use it correctly and position yourself well, it can gather you frags all day long. So Astralis now adjusting themselves. They're going to go for a double AWP on the terrorist side of Mirage. Pretty unorthodox, but we'll see what they can bring to the table here. Early smokes and flashes looking like it'll be going over towards the A site. Spiro should get an easy kill here. There it is. Takes down Dupree, but Device answers back straight away.
Device tries to find the second one back towards CT stairs as well. Flash comes out. He jumps into the corner. He's waiting for Zippix now to be the one to get into place because he's gone down. Zippix does get out of apartments in the meantime, in from Palace to the back of the site. Not spotted, but can't find the angle. So CSGO Lounge is going to rotate toward three players now in CT. Bomb will get planted default. Malzino not in a position with that auto sniper to fire through the box, but does have the angle held so that the information is he could only go toward A ramp. So they know at least where the post plant player has gone, but Michu finding Kerrigan means Zippix has to be extremely clever in this position, and three players going to walk toward Cajun B.
Yeah, this should be a must-win round for Zippix and Cajun. Fine kills. Now a 2-on-2. AWP on the retake as well. This becomes a lot more difficult. It's a decent plan for connector as well. CTs need to find a kill. It's not going to happen. Wow. All four going in favor of Astralis. So what seemed like a dream setup there for Lounge Gaming actually falls apart and turns into a nightmare. A plays five, and that's the round you've got to win. 4-on-2.
That's so sick. I mean, they knew exactly where Cajun was because, again, Malzino just held the angle so that he... Okay, he could have been in sandwich at the worst case scenario, but they knew there was one at A main. And yet still Zippix tears them apart when they overcommit to it, and Cajun picks up two of his own.
Well, CTs are going to be forcing up into this one. No kids, lack of nades, max 7 once again to Spiro. He takes quite a lot of damage, goes down towards 68 HP. Astralis looking very comfortable right now, still rolling that double AWP setup. Maybe Device and Kerrigan. Maybe misses AWPing on Mirage a little bit, so he's just piping up and having a go. But Zippix, first player to drop their Manice, does find one. A kill they desperately needed. Once again, if you don't have kits or grenades, you need to have something to work with. But me who gives it straight back to Kerrigan.
Dupree can sit here patiently because they have catwalk control. There's no one that's going to be able to push from behind him. And Kerrigan proves that point by taking down Manice. And as such, look how easy it is for Dupree to focus on a single task. Malzino had no chance. Device walking into beat. Has the right angle covered off, but doesn't spot him yet.
Look at Spiro's position though. He's got a max 7 and players coming from short and apartments as well. Almost impossible situation for him. Dupree finds a final kill. And Astralis now, it was a rough start to the game, going on 3-0, but looking very comfortable indeed. Now we're going to round number 15. Just going to be pistols for Lounge Gaming. They have got 5-7 CZs and Desert Eagles. Once again, someone needs to make something happen, push somewhere, find a Desert Eagle headshot. Can't allow Astralis to actually have full reign of the map. It may look like it's going only in one direction, Matt. Feel free to go with that.
Yeah, I already said it. Yeah. Everyone already knows.
Okay. Right.
Simon Cowell must be like your idol for putting that group together, though, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
I figured. You're about as grouchy as he is. Smoke from Malzino.
As handsome.
Well, sure, if you want to be as handsome as him, go right ahead. I mean, you could have said as handsome as a doorknob, and it might have been better. Zipek's going to Molotov off the corner at Cat. That means Kerrigan just has to hold from afar this time. So despite not being pushed up as he was with the rifle, they could still get the same sort of setup toward that connector. Innocent that wants to try and shut it down with the Deagle, and Kerrigan again changes the play style, but still does the same job. Michu gone, connector open, available, no one to flank it.
There it is, Kerrigan coming to life there. It's going to be four frags, very quick ones indeed from Astralis as they do take over the A site, very convincingly indeed. Spiro, now the last player remaining in the window room. I want to say it. Come on, Zipex, finish it off. Dead now, of course. As he does get the final frags, it'll be 10-5 in the first half here. So like I said, Lounge looking very strong in this opening segments. The pistol round should have gone in Astralis' favor, you have to say, Matt, with Dupree on that backstab. But I think we're going to hear from Smix and see what's going down on the floor with the players.
That is correct, Henry. I've been here since the beginning of the match just to check out what the vibe has been like with the players as the match has been going along. And I started over at the Lounge section just because I was curious to see what their comms are like. And throughout the match, I was actually surprised to see that despite being the underdog, they've had very calm and focused comms. Now, towards the end of the first half, they did get a little bit quieter, so I'm concerned. And maybe that's a sign that they're losing confidence, but I guess we'll find out in the second half. And with Astralis, Kerrigan is still, of course, in-game leading, but I believe he switched chairs because I was talking with Frederick, their manager, and he mentioned that that has to do with some change-ups and strategies that they've been really focusing on with their results lately and really trying to change things up on their side. So that was actually really interesting to hear.
Yeah, very interesting stuff. We'll see if Lounge can get back into this half. Maybe they need to lounge a little bit more, Henry.
I think we all do. We've started it. Maybe the other
maybe not Freakazoid. He should lounge a little less. We've seen what happens when he tries it.
Old reference to you there.
Thank you, Smix, as always. Good information. Again, I'm kind of liking that halftime report stuff. It's kind of fun.
Yeah, it's interesting to see the emotions of the players and what's going on down there.
Gives another dynamic.
This is even more interesting. Kerrigan somehow on the CT side. Oh, the pistol has got all the way to the top of middle. There is a terrorist waiting for him, though. Oh, the timing's working out so badly for Kerrigan now. He's going to get absolutely wrecked as he walks around this corner. I was about to say goodnight, but all of a sudden he hits the kill. How is Mihu not got that one?
That's a bit confusing, but Astralis will take it. Yeah, well, this is a problem now because it puts them a man down on the pistol now. Keep in mind, they did win the first pistol round despite going down a man. Still only managed the five rounds, though. Astralis, this time it's Kerrigan once more. Going to take Spiro, and Cajun B falls off. It's Zipix that's going to be under threat over on the B site. They jumped out the window, so he won't have the read on the first player, but wants the second, now realizes they're both in the site, and he's actually moved accordingly. It's getting Kerrigan in another good position. That's four kills for him now. Zipix just baits them in.
Lovely stuff from Kerrigan. As I said, you should have got that kill dead to rights. It was perfectly lined up for them. It looked like they knew what was coming as well, but Kerrigan finds four kills and taking minimal damage as well. He's going to be innocent. He does do a lot to Dupree, but it's not enough. They're aware of his position now. 35 seconds remain. He's only got a Glock, no armor, and KCMB gets the final frag. So a clean sweep there for Astralis. Kerrigan, certainly the MVP. It was a bold move to get towards the top of middle, but it pays dividends for him.
Why not? And again, you said it. Kerrigan, that first kill, I mean, that should have gone the other way. Michu had to hit that. It's a whole different round right there, just in the fact that Kerrigan gets four.
Can we get a replay of that, please, Reduction, and see what's... not right now, whenever you're ready.
Just be rude about it, Henry.
Whenever you're ready.
Well, the smokes are going to go out. They are going to go to one rifle only. It's on Kerrigan, no surprise. He built up the most money with those four kills. The rest onto the SMGs. And the smoke on Catwalk. Spiro gets into that little nook between the box and crate. Tries to fire with the Deagle into the window, but no one's there.
Well, Lounge Gaming, of course, have forced up here. If you don't get the bomb down, it's pretty standard to get the Tech-9's armors out. They have got a smoke on me here, so potentially can do something with that. They're currently having the bomb towards the B apartments, just holding up for any CT pushes coming in. It actually looks like there may be one, potentially. As we can see, Dupree scouting at that lower round. And he goes with the first pick. Actually takes on Zipix as well. That's the B side open. It's only going to be one player on towards short. He gets taken down as well. A chance. Something to work with here for CSGO Lounge.
Are you going to try and hold it with the P90? Does get Spiro down, but like you said, the bomb planted. This is a big win in this situation. They've picked up the UMP on Innocent. Going to try and push with it. Kerrigan has to hold with the M4. Does. And now that SMG is so far out of reach, they can't try and reuse it. So it is going to be limited to just the two Tech-9s.
No kits on the CT stage. There's still a big chance here for Lounge Gaming.
And not only that, Device on 47. Those Tech Nines could wreak havoc onto him. They do so. Kerrigan goes down, though, instead. That makes it even worse, but a good angle held from Dupree. The Tech Nine, or excuse me, the P90, but has to hold that smoke. He's got the angle. Mousino finds him. There is a kid on top of it, but they've got to find each other in the smoke. And Mousino gets away from it. The knife was considered, and Mousino gets it with the Tech Nine.
Lovely stuff from him there. He knew he had to do something. As soon as the smoke bloomed, had to make something happen. Jumps in, and luckily for him, it was the Kerrigan with low HP, but it was the one defusing the bomb as well. So just needed to find one bullet, finally gets it. And that was the round over. As I mentioned before, the CT had no kits. It's going to be a force buy from Astralis to answer back straight away. So a big round from Lounge Gaming, but is it enough to hold them off? As you get a scout on towards Kerrigan and Desert Eagles and Piz250's rest of his team. It's a fast B play here potentially as well. Flashes go over, KGB gets the first kill. So the rest of his teammates now are committed to that B rush.
Zimpix is completely overwhelmed. Not a chance when you look up and see the X-ray. There's three players directly in front of him. Doesn't even manage one. Michu goes down from Cajun. That's the only kill so far, but another bomb plant, Lounge Gaming. And if we said there was no kits last time with rifles, there's no kits and even less rifles this time. But Astralis have time. They don't need to push into this too hard. They don't need to force up in the coming rounds. They've got a cushion. They'll still have, if I can do math, four rounds to work with after this, Henry. That was a hard moment.
Device has got the AK-47 and Kerrigan and the scout. They've got a head armor as well. Considering the bomb's down, don't have kits once again. I agree with this. Keep the weapons they have, even if it's just the upgraded pistols with their armor. And they can take that to the next round, which would be a difficult buy regardless. So it's absolutely fine. So this really will be dropped. There's significant damage, but not quite enough to pick the frag there. So saving the AK, scouts, and Deagle. And let's get line actually with two MAC-10. So that potentially could be interesting as we go into round number 19. It's going to be two rounds in a row now for the Polish squad. We'll see how Astralis adjust. See if they go for that initial pick as well. As Cajun B, they've got the first Eagle kill. Can he replicate it?
If he can. Spiro, already inside of the palace with the MAC-10, has Innocent on the same weapon. So both of them playing on different sides right now, trying to get as much information as possible. Kerrigan on the scout is going to be the only one over B playing that jump position. Probably one of the strongest jump positions in the game.
I would say so. That and Cash as well. Maybe Dust 2 on the A side.
Yeah, Dust 2 A side for sure. But Innocent smokes off top of the connector. He won't have to worry about a flank, but he doesn't know that. So still has to be a little bit careful in his approach here. He can use the box to spot Dupree instead, who gets the Deagle shot. We often talk about his ability with that gun, but it was just fast enough for Innocent not to be able to deny it. Zimpix does still get forced back, though, four plays two. Bomb going to try and go down, but Cajun B, he's trying to buy space. Gets the dink as well. Unfortunately, it's not enough. Mousino down to one HP, and the bomb does get planted. If he could have denied it,
yep,
it could have been cool.
That could have been very cool. Luckily for Lounge Gaming, though, the plant was in a safe position for that specific scenario. So managed to get it down, and Cajun B doesn't get anything for his money apart from a dink. And now 11-8. We do have a buy coming from Astralis. Not the best, though. Device unable to get the AWP just yet. They still don't have a single kit. Four M4s and a Famas. And also no incendiaries, which can be very beneficial on Mirage. We'll see what they can do with this one. Three players towards A, two towards B. Cajun B normally pushing aggressive offshore.
He's going to sit Cajun B this time a little bit more passively, though. Which does give underpass up, see if they can try and use it to get mid. They've got three players at the top of it right now, CSGO Lounge. Device, the only one really that can do anything about it immediately. He'll call for Cajun's help if he needs it, but we'll see if this plays out, because right now he's still, again, in a passive position to try and support Zipix inside of the V-site instead.
No. Gaming will be just trying to gain them in control, as you said. It's going to be Innocent working that underpass area, smoking off towards connector, taking vision away from the CTs, Molotov's the window as well, so this does make sure that's a big possibility for them, gain control of that ladder room potentially, as he makes his way towards the connector. He's going to be taken down through the smoke though, by Dupree. Lovely stuff by him. Gives him the man advantage as well. The CTs, who are on a difficult buy, now gives him something to work. He can sit back and force the terrorists to come to a bombsite.
Zeno meets you. Shuts down both players. To try and push back into mid. Kerrigan now left alone inside of the A-site. Connector given up, so he's completely isolated, and he doesn't even get a single kill out of it, because Michu is immediately there. And now Zeno's going to hold off against this plant, watching the box, expecting the jump, but Device still finds the angle. Nearly spots the guy planting the bomb as well. That could have been huge if he had taken down Spiro as well. But now he's low, 23 HP, and Zipix only arriving. just now. No kit.
This is another save, I think. No kit, like you said. 3-on-2, both very low HP. Now committed. It's going to be ZipX stuck towards CT Sport. Mihu pines up both frags. And from what I could see there, Astralis had the man advantage. And like I said, they could just fall back to the bomb sites then and force Lounge Gaming to make the next move. It seemed like Cajun just wanted to push offshore and find the next frag. He got punished and a teammate did as well. And it all fell apart from that point. Device did what he could, boosting himself up in CT spawn, but didn't find anything more than one kill.
So 10-5 at the half. Astralis wins pistol. We now sit at 11-9 because Lounge win the eco. And it's not often that we say... It's actually one of the things that we do say about Astralis is that they don't lose to lower teams. It's not often that we see this happening. So, you know, they may struggle in semis, but it's against top teams that normally get the better of them. So this is an impressive game shaping up right now for Lounge Gaming as Dupree is going to try and get more aggression back on toward the A ramp. Has to watch this with the 5-7. Thankfully, the player on his right is low, but unfortunately, he has to cross over the path of two players to find that alone. But Device again, from the same spot Dupree hit it with the Deagle earlier, finds Innocent with the headshot.
On three now. Going to be Device and ZipX finding kills with the pistols. All of a sudden, they have the man advantage. Spiro's on 11 HP as well with the AWP. Bomb yet to be planted, so that's going to be stranded on the A side. And you can see one player from T Spawn as well coming in. We'll see whether they can do anything with this. It'll be a massive round for Astralis to get back into this one. Fake plant does go. And Molotov towards Connector.
That holds Device's position away, but Cajun, you're right, is still getting into a decent position. I love that he's gone toward Palace as well because it gets him that much closer with only the pistol and the 18 HP to work with.
He could rush this, stop the bomb going down, decides to go more conservative. They have no idea he's here. First kill comes in. There it is. Just going to be one remaining. That's Mouse. Gets one, gets two.
Oh.
One on one now. Both players low HP. One bullet is all it requires.
Oh! And it's the Deagle Cajun through the edge of the box! That is insane that he pulls that off. And you saw he had them both lined up, but the flash came in on the first approach, and Cajun's going to get the defuse. So it's an eco to pull them right back in, 12-9.
What a round, and what a play from Cajun as well. Like he said, I really like the fact he came from Palace. It's quite predictable. A lot of players will backstab from the lower ramp. He had enough time to play with. LG were quite apprehensive of their plan, trying to bait out any CTs to face when they were fake planting there. And he came in. He had the opportunity to stop the bomb going down. Went for the more conservative player, as I said. Gets the bomb planted down, and then it's one-on-one. We see it from Miles' point of view. Gets blown up through the box, and it's now 12-9. Astralis bouncing back. They're going to have the AWP this time. Same story for Spear as well. Very defensive setup and a default play from Lounge Gaming to kick things off.
Innocent watching the bottom of the A slope in case anyone wants to push through. And Spiro, he's going to get toward the underpass with the AWP. He may just sit top stairs. Most likely it'll sit top stairs and watch toward the, yeah, there you go, toward the apartments. In case anyone pushes in. But it's Kerrigan, Dupree, and Device on the A site.
This is looking like an AXQ coming in from Lounge Gaming, going to be setting up three players. Smoke on the steps towards jungle, CT spawn, maybe one on the sites as well to get the disguise planting. But you can see Astralis ready for this. Kerrigan, Device, Dupree, all on the sites. And Spiro trying to actually show his hand towards that side. I was about to say, bring some attention towards there, but he's actually found a kill, legging ZipX and taking down the HE. This will be the execute now. This is working very well for Lounge Gaming, but Kerrigan does find one.
Kerrigan finding one is going to allow him into the site as well. The floodgates open, but he does fall back far enough so that he won't be in the open, in behind the firebox, smoke to cover him off, and Device getting Mauzino as they look for him. Gives Kerrigan more space to work with. Good push through from an ease. He's gotten far up the connector, but he's immediately shut down by Dupree on the backside of the smoke. And it's a two-man advantage. Spiro finds Cajun B, not expecting at all that he would be on that position at Catwalk.
So this still is possible. 23 seconds, and Innocent with the bomb, going towards B apartments now. He has the runs all the way, and Spiro has got control of the side, so problem is, there is another CT with him. He's unaware of this situation right now. They have to force a plan straight away.
He's going to get there with about 6 seconds to do so as well, so Spiro has to hold this angle to make this possible at all.
He can't win. Dupree surely just going to stop the bomb game.
Yeah, there you go.
He can't do anything about that. They did everything they could. It's the only option, and unfortunately, he can't cover every single angle there. Dupree saves the round, and Spiro does go down in the end as well. Did he die after the money? I'm not sure. No, he's okay.
He's fine, yep.
There it is. 13 plays 9 now. Money in a pretty dire position for Lounge Gaming. They've got 3 AKs, 2 Tech 9s. They have got the smokes. So we saw them then. It actually was going very well for them indeed. Spiro going over towards the B apartments. Does find the kill onto ZipX as well. He doesn't really get hurt for it. Execute comes in. You'd think that with the man advantage, they would step up there. But it's Kerrigan to find the first kill and give a decent call off. Held them off with the flashbangs. And they managed to get a decent retake in, forcing them back towards B. But here we go. Round number 23. Device with the first kill towards middle. Takes down Innocent. That's one of the Tecton's drops. So three AKs still survive.
Oh, Minis though. He's gonna get pushed up the stairwell by that Molotov. He's gonna be in the open. Dupree and Shadow not even checked. Now Zeno down. Minis has still bought space out of this though. No one peeked that. Oh, missed thrown. But that forces Dupree out and actually works because he gets Minis. He's dropped in the end by Spiro. But it's all too easy as Astralis find themselves now very near the finish line.
Indeed. We can see now, with Astralis one round away from map and indeed match point, the money for Lounge Gaming is very low indeed. They've got about 2k average. They're looking like they will be taking the conservative approach. Just having some Desert Eagles and P250s, that's about it. No grenades, so this is almost certainly going to 15 plays 9, unless there's some sort of absolutely monster play coming in from these Deegs.
So Astralis putting themselves in a good position to find themselves in the upper bracket, that much closer as KGB to the shot on Michu to the playoffs, which will take place, don't forget, this weekend at DreamHack Masters Malmo. And if you haven't got your tickets yet, you can do so still. It's definitely still possible. DreamHack or masters.dreamhack.com. Limited edition, but you can get premium. You get food included with that. You're on the floor, and the general admission are still available as well, which is for the bleacher seats. But again, Astralis, they could be there. You could as well. We'll see if Zipix is going to help that. It's the Minis that goes down. And although the low HP, look at it right now. Device 29, Cajun 22, Zipix 2, our favorite number, Henry.
For this tournament, at least. The three players for Lounge Gaming now.
Make it now two.
Sorry?
I said make it now. Two players.
Yep. All good stuff. And it's going to be Mouse and Spiro now make it one as he's got the Desert Eagle in hand. With five players to find. That helps, though. Finds the kill on towards Zipix. Bomb still down, time ticking, and Dupree to take Astralis to a match point here, 15-9. And they did take the eco that round just to make sure they had weapons going into round number 25. So now I'm going to need 6 rounds in a row to actually keep them alive and just go to overtime here. This is where Astralis can afford to be a little bit more audacious, more aggressive, and just try and take the game towards LG. The thing is with the pass for Astralis, that's been one of their problems, actually. When they're in these tight situations in semi-finals, they have these great terrorist halves, and then when they get to the CT and they actually can see themselves touching distance of the win, they go very apprehensive, they go very turtle-like, and they don't want to do anything that may throw them the game. And that's a real problem for them. They actually don't have that mentality to be confident and push down and potentially lose their life to actually find that first frag and surprise terrorist. And that's what people normally capitalize in those big moments, but I don't think the same's going to happen against Loud Gaming, I have to say.
Yeah, well, starts off well. Damage still favors, despite that nade going on to Cajun. Still favors right now Astralis, but that certainly will not. Michu taking back device in the window. Dupree's got to come over to compensate for this, and they've got so much control. The boost up. Dupree almost walks into a slaughter, and he'll fall back. Michu left on 1 HP, but Spiro's got Dupree, and he's Michu, speaking of, already out of that connector position. Kerrigan's going to find him. That's a bit overkill considering he had 1 HP, but the op's in decent position to try and cover off that connector now. And oh, did he? I think he may have just spotted him.
Yeah, he's waiting for him, but he at least has the intel. We can see Dupree.
Yeah, there it is. The call's made.
It was actually Cajun, but yeah, he gets the kill. Now it's a 3-on-3. Terrorists are going to be forcing their wave into from lower ramp. All three players committed here. Need to find his next pick. They have got 3 AKs in hand and Molotovs as well, so potentially could shut out a couple of CTs while the bomb went down.
Innocent's going to Molotov as well toward jungle. That means Kerrigan's the only one in direct position to hold it off. Good read. Innocent stares at him. He goes down immediately, and Minis is planting the bomb, but this puts Cajun in an awkward position. Minis is even smarter still because he's not going to rotate out into the open, knowing that it's very likely that was the only player on the CT stairs. Smoke on Palace. Cajun B has to find a way into this site. It's a double player position right now. Innocent and Mauzino both toward the A slope that they have to cross over. So despite that they'll force Minis out, there's still a good chance that there's a setup that'll deny them getting close enough. And that Flames, they just barely spread far enough, but Zipix has it. He's got the second as well. Zipix is looking for more, but he runs out of ammo. Cajun's gonna hit it with the op. Brilliant setup, the 1-2 punch, and they will get the defuse. Astralis, 16-9, I guess the Flaren was right.
He was, that guy's always right. But there it is, Astralis. Looks a little bit shaky at the start, but once they got rolling with the money and every clutch situation seems to be going in their favor as well. 4-on-2s and stuff like that. You felt like Lounge Gaming definitely had a chance on the second half to actually bring that
and
back.
Appropriate that the cleaner got the last kill. If you haven't seen it yet, look on Twitter. There's an excellent picture of KGB's new team uniform.
Excellent.
It's excellent.
It's interesting. Quite disturbing, some might say.
But it's definitely accurate because he does clean this one up. So they'll move into the upper bracket, Lounge Gaming. 9 rounds. It was a decent second half. I mean, T-side especially.
Yeah,
you wouldn't expect that against Astralis. They got things really rolling and all in the back of an eco as well.
That play from Cajun in the Water Palace got the bomb down. And the 1v1 got them straight back into it. So that's going to be it. Astralis go through. And That was better. I wasn't expecting such a close game, to be fair. All the 69ers suggest it was close. Lots of rounds where it actually should have gone in favor of CSGO Lounge. Like, remember, 4-on-2s and stuff they're throwing away. And you have to be fair as well. Astralis with that pistol round, they probably should have won that round in the opening sectors of this one. Do you remember Dupree with that burst fire?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that was, I mean, unless he thought he was a lot closer, that really didn't make much sense to me.
Well, the burst fire is notoriously horrible in CSGO.
In CSGO originally, it was actually incredible because it was like one of the things they had to nerf at one of the first patches. But we do have the man himself standing by. Why the burst fire, Dupree? Maybe Smix can tell us.
All right, so before we get to the questions, Dupree, Sadakist wants to know why the burst fire, Dupree.
It was an honest mistake. Yeah. It was a mistake. And that's why we lost the pistol round. I was like, I was like, just wait, device. I'm going to come behind him. I'm going to kill him. And then, like, I just lined up the shot, and I was like, and I shot, I was like, burst. I was like, yep, I put it on burst. I lost. Rip. So, yeah.
All right, well, now that we have that taken care of, well, first of all, congratulations, 16-9. It's actually the prediction that Fiflarin made before the analysts were making predictions, and he predicted 69, and that's exactly what the score was. Now, let's talk about that map overall. Obviously, it did come out in the favor of your guys. It looked solid overall, but what did you think personally?
We should have closed it out a lot earlier. I don't think they deserved to get 9 rounds. Mainly we lost the pistol round because of myself. That could have been like 3 rounds for us. We lost the second round at CT as well because of a little bit of mistake. So overall, I think it should have been like 16 or 4 or 5 or something. But overall, like, we still won because we played better, I'd say. So yeah.
Well, I was talking with Frederick, your manager, backstage as we watched the game, and I was asking him how you guys are feeling overall at this tournament, and he mentioned you guys are feeling pretty good. I know that you guys came off a really tough loss after Columbus, so just wondering personally from your perspective, how has that been since the time after the major leading up to now?
It was a tough one that we lost the semifinal again. Especially after we played so well against Fnatic, we started out really, like, we just played poorly against Na'Vi without taking anything away from them. I still say that we're trying some new stuff. That's what everyone says is the new tournament, but we are trying some new things. I'm not going to reveal what it is, obviously, but so far it works out. So I just hope it's going to be like that. And obviously, we just new confidence, new tournament, so yeah.
Well, you just mentioned Fnatic and Na'Vi, and speaking of which, Fnatic is a team that's not here, which is, I'm sure, good news for everyone that is already here. And Na'Vi, who is also, you know, a world-class team, they don't have Guardian, their star player, here as well. So that being said, I was talking to Frederick, and he said, this looks pretty good for my boys.
Oh, yeah, obviously it is. I think it's a shame, obviously, because I feel bad for both Olafmeister and Guardian, which have problems with their hands, or the wrist, or whatever it is. And for the actual competition, I think it's sad, because you want the best team, so you get the most out of everything. And if we're going to beat up, well, if we're going to beat Na'Vi and we're going to beat them without having Guardian, I don't see it as an actual win, because Guardian is a big part of their team. So obviously, I would have much rather ran both Fnatic and actually Na'Vi with a full lineup here, just to make the competition and the actual, well, also for the spectators, make it a lot more enjoyable. So, but obviously, yeah, it has weakened, obviously, since Fnatic's not here, but also weakened Na'Vi. But I still think that Starix is going to fill in okay, not in the same way as Guardian would do, obviously, but yeah. I don't know, it looks good, but yeah. Overall, I'd still want them to be here.
Yeah, and before we get carried away talking about what can happen further on in the tournament, of course, you have to win your next match, which will be either NIP or Dignitas. Now, NIP, you guys have played them twice this year. It was at ESL Pro League, and you've actually lost both times. And your Dignitas brothers, your Danish brothers, you've played them 5 times this year, and you've won every single time. So I'm wondering, I can't help but feel like you're probably leaning towards, you know, no mercy on your brothers there.
Yeah, obviously we want to play Dignitas mostly, but then again, we also want to try and beat NIP, and it would be nice to do it here. I'm sure we can do it. It's just about a little bit of a mental block, probably, and I think they have a little bit of a mental advantage against us. But yeah, I would love to play either team. It doesn't really matter to me. I just want to play CS. That's basically it.
All right, now before I let you go, I've been personally asked by my producer to ask you guys, because Astralis, you know, you guys have swag that's coming out. So can you reveal a little bit more details about all the clothes and things that the fans can look forward to purchasing?
I can just say that it looks really awesome, and you should definitely buy it, because then you'll have just as much swag as we do. No, it's we're gonna start selling some stuff, and that's really good for our brand. Obviously, we want to try and promote ourselves a lot more since we are kind of our own organization. I hope that people will support us, and yeah.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Dupree, and of course, best of luck no matter which team you face tomorrow. Of course, as always, we are going to a very, very short break, and when we come back, we will be looking over that match that just occurred.
CSGO Lounge versus Astralis has gone one way and one way only for the Danes. They picked up the win. There was some valiant attempts, especially from Mihu, a name that we were highlighting on the desk, but Astralis did prevail in the end. A strong second half performance. We got to see Lounge looking pretty good on their T side, but Astralis prevail. And actually Dupree in the interview suggesting he wasn't actually happy with that result. Those 9 rounds, he wasn't happy that they gave them away. And I think we're going to be seeing those perfectionist kind of, those hints of perfectionism from the boys from Astralis. They know this is the tournament for them to try and to pick up that victory, and they're trying to start as strong as they possibly can.
Pretty harsh there, to be honest, saying that, I don't think they deserve 9 rounds. I think it should have been
pretty brutal.
16-4, 16-5 for us.
I like it. I like this newfound swagger in Astralis. You think back to the pause at MLG, like this newfound like attitude they have where they're just like, whatever, we're just going to do, and maybe that's the trick to get over that semifinal hop. Maybe it's just to like have this like false sense of like swagger, just overwhelming confidence in your game and how you act as a player. So
I mean, we were talking about it coming into the game as well, that Astralis barely makes any mistakes, and yeah, Dupree, he has a point. They weren't supposed to actually give out like 9 rounds like that. They had a bunch of rounds that they should have won. Sure, Lounge had a bunch of rounds they should have won, and Astralis ended up winning them. Overall, I think it was a very solid performance from Astralis, as per usual, coming into the group stage match. For Lounge, I mean, yeah, we saw some good plays here and there, and their T side, especially versus a team like Astralis, that was the half that they had coming into the game, where they actually had to perform, because I mean, on their seat side, you always know that Astralis can have
a good
seat on that map.
Meant they granted them a couple of rounds by losing that second round after winning Pistol, and you need to realize Lounge won 9 rounds. They won first half Pistol and won the second round in the second half, which also gave them a couple of rounds for free, so to speak. So looking at just the gun rounds themselves, they didn't actually win as many. You can see in the first half, at times they did try to adjust. We saw the mid push from Mihu, I think it was, and that was a good call here and there. But they were getting caught off guard by some really, I can't say silly moves, but you know, some cheesy moves by Kerrigan, especially moving through that window area, managing to catch 2 people off guard. You need to be aware, at least your mid player needs to be aware that can happen, and he needs to give info to his team that that might have happened, because he can't, you know, watch everything at the same time, both connector and window.
Did we catch what Kerrigan's route was? It was through window then?
Yes.
Like boosted?
I think that one round he was boosted through the smoke and then moved just through the through the vents while his team drew attention to the other side. So that exactly the mid player would need to focus on something else. And they didn't have a player in ladder room either. Was might have spotted it, but
was that what Dupree was hinting at when he says trying new things? I mean, like, he says that a lot of teams say that coming into new tournaments, right? Sometimes it feels like a bit of a kind of, they're just trying to keep their opponents on their toes. Did we see any indication of Astralis trying something new, or is that to be seen later in the tournament?
I think one of the new things I noticed was KJNB being the second player with the double op. It's been a while. It's usually been Kerrigan and Device who do that. Kerrigan specifically loves opping on Mirage, and now that they've made Device their primary, yeah. So I think KJNB, I think maybe one of those tricks we'll see this event is KJNB picking up an op a little bit more.
And a little bit more aggressive, actually, I'd say.
Yeah.
On the seat side, a little bit more aggressive, just trying to get some control of the map, make sure that the opponents that they play against won't get as much control, and the executes. And obviously that paid off on some rounds, that didn't really pay off on the other rounds.
Also, on the T side, they seem to have picked up the pace in some rounds as well, you know, going for a fast A split and so on. And I think it's really good in a sense that it's something that can work, but also you're being more unpredictable by adding that to your arsenal, right? So then teams playing against you on the C side, they have to be aware, oh, but they have that fast push as well. We need to maybe spend some nades early because of that. And then they can also fall back to, you know, taking it slowly, then going for a set execute later on.
I mean, it's not like Astralis have always had a tag attached to them like they're a slow team, right? But you're just suggesting that they don't always have a lot of pace in their T side.
Yeah, I think at times not enough, right? They started changing that some time ago, implementing exactly because of the reason I was speaking about. But I just feel that right now it's a bit more obvious that they're trying to do
fair,
it.
Fair. It's like Navi, for example. Navi has a very slow approach, even in their standard rounds, taking control of maps, whereas Astralis have essentially the same approach, it's just they do it a little bit faster. Yeah. That's why, for example, Navi, when you play with them, you're always expecting a slow round, right? But then sooner or later, maybe once or twice a half, you see that fast push that they have. Astralis pretty much taking a page from Navi's book there. It's like, yeah, we can take over areas slower, we can take it over in normal pace, but we also have these fast pushes that no one really tends to expect from us.
But Navi did against Astralis, actually, in their semifinal at Columbus. caught them completely off guard with some really fast
strats. Yeah, those tempo switches are brutal to deal with. And if you time it right, if you time it when your opponents are on like a really weak buy, like a really weak economy, when they don't have like the smokes or the nades to like block you off opening up, it can be so deadly.
Well, let's take a look at the stats to see if that does indicate, you know, who was necessarily stepping up from Astralis as they did pick up that win, and also who from Lounge was kind of delivering in buckets. It was, of course, you can see Mihu delivering alongside Maus for the Polish side. But then on the other side of things, you know, you talked about Cajun B picking up the AWP. Looks like it was working well for him. The cleaner. Oh, have you seen that Photoshop?
It's beautiful.
It's... Check out Sadie Mitch's retweet.
Back in my head now.
Yeah, you'd never be able to see him without a French maid outfit on, that's for sure.
Some people work incredibly fast when given a task in Photoshop. It's impressive.
Yep.
But, I mean, is there anything to draw from these stats? It looks pretty kind of
Glam
and done.
The main offer for Lounge, obviously, is Fero had a very, very quiet first half. Essentially non-existent, same as Meniz. Meniz is normally the guy that you tend to look at as being quite a stable player. Just there generally, and he also had a very poor performance. So you have two essentially of the launch, one, especially Sphero, obviously main offer being one of the most important players on the team, not showing up at all. And then from Astralis, you see there, I mean, Kerrigan, his best map by far, and he shows this again and again. Great performance, even without the op this time.
Yep.
And I'm sure it's going to be haunting their nightmares, that route that Kerrigan did take on that T side, just getting behind them, getting Balcony and CT. Silly stuff happening across the board. But we do see Lounge concede. Any closing thoughts from you, Jason? It does feel like it's just Astralis, it's group stage, it's standard.
Yeah, I'm not sure you can really take too much away about what their kind of future level is going to be. Yeah. But I mean, it definitely, yeah, Astralis, good start to the tournament. They always tend to do this in the group stage, so no surprises there whatsoever for me.
And there's a lot more excitement on the horizon for this group. Let's not forget what is lying in the wings. We have NIP and Dignitas waiting to play. That's going to be an exciting game. You can see nods and smiles starting to creep onto the faces of the desk because this is going to be a big game. You're going to be seeing a Scandinavian affair and in Sweden, no less. Denmark is a stone's throw away as well. It is going to be fantastic. And of course, if you are local to the area, Sweden, Denmark, wherever you are, if you can get here for Saturday and Sunday, you're in for a treat and you can still get tickets. They are still available. So do be sure to check them out. The actual URL is, I'm going to get this right, masters.dreamhack.com. Be sure to check that out and you can go ahead and grab your tickets, either normal or there's a premium, which gets you not only food but also seating right in the center of the Malmo Arena.
And
so you
beer.
Guys go check that out. And beer, of course. Janka reminding you of all the important things.
So much authority on that.
And beer.
Yeah, and beer.
Well, there's beer available, yeah. So you do be sure to go ahead and look at those tickets. Once again, masters.dreamhack.com. And while you're checking that out, we are going to take a break. Before I do that, a reminder about the Score Esports application. I've told you once and I'll tell you again. You can grab it on your phone. But also, what's important about this is it's not only news, but it's also stats. If you want to get your KDs, the stuff that we've been throwing up on the screen, you can access on your phone on the go. So you go check that out. We're going to take 5-1. We come back. We've got a big one. It's going to be NIP. You can see them on your screens. They're warming up quite literally with those heating pads. And their opponents, Dignitas, are ready to give them a run for their money. We'll be back in 5, guys, with more Counter-Strike Global Offensive.